Township of Parsippany Troy Hills, Township Council Special Meeting, September 9th, 2014. Meeting called to order by myself at 6:30 PM. Please rise for flag salute. Mr. Valori, if you would.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Mr. Karifi.
Here.
Mr. DePiero. I'm sorry, he's absent. Mr. Paluso.
Present.
Mr. Stanton.
Here.
Mr. Valori.
Here.
Others present, Mayor James Barberio, Ellen M. Sandman, Business Administrator, Paula Cazarelli, Assistant Business Administrator, John Inglesino, Esquire, Township Attorney, Yancy Wazermas, Township Clerk, and Ann Cuccio, CFO. The agenda of this meeting is the extent known is as follows. Closed session and presentation regarding RD Realty versus Township of Parsippany Troy Hills. Formal action may or may not be taken.
Statement of compliance. Adequate notice of the meeting has been provided in accordance with the requirements of the Open Public Meetings Law. By filing the notice in the office of the Township Clerk and by posting the meeting notice on the bulletin board at the Municipal Building on September 2nd, 2014, where it has remained posted since that date. A legal notice appeared in the Daily Record on September 4, 2014 and was quoted by fax to the Star Ledger and Parsippany Life on September 2nd, 2014.
Closed session, whereas the Open Public Meeting Act, PL 1975, Chapter 231, permits the exclusion of the public from a meeting in certain circumstances, and whereas the Township Council is of the opinion that certain circumstances presently exist, and whereas the Township Council wishes to discuss attorney-client privilege and the following litigation matter, RD Realty versus Township of Parsippany Troy Hills, and whereas minutes will be kept, and once the matter involving the confidentiality of the above no longer requires confidentiality, the minutes can be made public. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills that the public be excluded from this meeting.
Second.
Motion made by myself, seconded by Mr. Stanton. Roll call.
Mr. Paluso.
Before I say anything, I just want to apologize to the audience for us being in closed session for such a period of time. You're coming here, you're going to be sitting here for a while, so I apologize. It's not something I recommend. Yes.
Mr. Stanton.
Yes.
Mr. Valori.
Yes.
Mr. Karifi.
Yes.
Make a motion to reconvene into open session.
Motion made by Mr. Stanton, seconded by Mr. Paluso. Roll call.
Mr. Paluso.
Yes.
Mr. Stanton.
Yes.
Mr. Valori.
Yes.
Mr. Karifi.
Yes. Okay, at this time we'll have a presentation for RD Realty versus Township of Parsippany Troy Hills.
Thank you, Mr.
Go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Council President. Can everybody hear me back there? Okay, if you can't, please speak up, but I feel like the sound system here works pretty good. A little bit of history. I think most of you are familiar with the history of this matter, but back, I believe it was October 1st of last year, there was an ordinance up for consideration concerning the Waterview site, which would have provided for 60 units of residential on the uplands portion of the property and 189,000 square feet of commercial space, which would have not only provided for commercial space but also big box commercial space. That ordinance was defeated by a vote of 3-2 and failed. Subsequent to that vote, the contract purchaser of the site, RD Realty, instituted a lawsuit against the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills, seeking to overturn the defeat of that ordinance and implement development potential on the site in the way of multifamily housing. That case is pending in Superior Court in Morristown. I've had several discussions with the governing body, who has authorized me to engage in settlement negotiations in order to seek to accomplish certain public policy objectives. In the interim, the township has applied for a grant through the Morris County Open Space Trust Fund in the amount of $3.5 million that was voted on by resolution in public. And the status of that grant application is also pending. We have now, at least I have, I think, taken the settlement negotiations with the developer about as far as we can. So this is the time where we would present, as I have to the governing body in closed session, and they have authorized me to make a public presentation to you all that would outline the terms of a prospective settlement agreement. Now, I do want to emphasize one point, and that is, although we have a settlement agreement that I think comports with the policy objectives that I was given to pursue, that does not mean that the governing body is obligated to vote for this settlement agreement. The governing body reserves the right to vote however they want to vote. I'm simply making the point that I think that the settlement agreement accomplishes the public policy purposes that were set forth. And we've taken that effort as far as it can go, and so now it's ready for consideration. The policy objectives that are seeking to be achieved is, number one, to preserve as much of the property as possible. Under the terms here, the 9.26-acre piece of property, which is the uplands piece on the northern end of the property, it is the property that is the subject of Parsippany's application before the Morris County Open Space Trust Fund. That property would be acquired under the settlement terms by the township and preserved as open space under the Morris County Preservation Trust Open Space Program. The only way to ensure that this property or any property is never to develop is to acquire property rights in it. And so if the township were to acquire this property as open space, it could never be developed for any purposes. It would be deed restricted. It would be a condition of the receipt of the funding. And there would never be any question whatsoever about the developability of that property. It would remain in its open state. The second objective was to prevent residential development, particularly multifamily residential development, from being developed on the site. Under the terms of this prospective settlement arrangement, there would be no residential development anywhere on the site. Again, the upland 9.26 acres would be preserved as open space, and the southern 17.38 acres along the Route 46 corridor would be rezoned for commercial purposes, and I'll elaborate more on about that. The third public policy objective was to prohibit target big box style type development along the Route 46 corridor. We heard a lot about Whole Foods. And I think Whole Foods is at least a desired a tenant, a desired prospective corporate citizen to the town. But the thought was that that big box, and I don't mean to single out Target, but that 100 to 140,000 square foot type of super tenant would pose with it impact on the police department, the municipal court system, et cetera. And the thought was to avoid that kind of development. And the settlement terms here would prohibit, on a permanent basis, any prospect of big box tenants on that site. And that would be accomplished by actually recording the settlement agreement, which would act as a deed restriction to prevent that type of development from happening in the future. So, what we would have conceptually is a much more moderate commercial development than what was proposed last fall. the type of commercial development that is contemplated by this settlement or would be permitted by the settlement would be a total of 152,000 square feet. Again, the previous proposal was for 189,000 square feet. And in a moment, Ed Snikas, the town planner, will show you illustrations. I'm going to give you some of the narrative now, but he's going to show you the illustrations because sometimes a picture is worth a thousand words, as they say. But under what's being proposed, there would be restrictions on the size of the tenants. We'll elaborate more on that in a few moments. The next objective, the fourth objective, was to achieve significant buffers. Buffers from forests and from intervale. The buffer under the prospective settlement from Forest Drive is 388 feet from property line to property line. And from the property line to the building itself, the retail building, would be 455 feet. On intervale, the minimum width buffer would be 108 feet from property line to property line, with a minimum setback at the narrowest point of intervale from the property line to the building of 196 feet. The basis for those buffers was to ensure that the ridge line, the trees, and the root systems along the ridge line would remain intact. So that essentially, when you drive onto Intervale Road, you would essentially have the same view in the future as you do now, notwithstanding the fact that there would be a commercial development on the site. And again, the township planner, Ed Snikas, will elaborate on that. The fifth policy objective was to ensure that any development on the site would result in a positive tax rateable for Parsippany, that there would be a financial benefit for Parsippany taxpayers, not only in year one, but on a going forward basis. That was particularly important to the policymakers in light of the challenges that every municipality has with budgets, particularly finding ways to increase revenues in these economic times. And in this regard, this particular prospective settlement project would result in a positive tax rateable for Parsippany residents of approximately $425,000 a year on an ongoing basis. I had the numbers exact, but Mr. Snikas messed me up a little bit when he told me that the benefit to the schools was slightly higher than what I had written down. So I had written down that the schools would see a $331,000 net positive economic benefit. $331,000 more each year for the school system. Oh, that's actually, I think, $342,000. That's where my Ed corrected me or gave me new information. Each year. On the municipal side, the benefit would be less. It would be $85,000 of a net benefit each year. That's a very conservative number, because when planners, make these calculations, they do so under formulas that are recognized in the planning industry. And as I think Mr. Snikas will elaborate in a few moments on, those numbers tend to be very conservative. They tend to overstate the impact on the services by upwards of 20%. So we anticipate that the $85,000 net benefit will be significantly higher, but that's the number that the formula produces. In addition to that, at least in the first year of the project, development fees, which would be your connection fees, construction fees, et cetera, would yield $735,000. Obviously, there's no service impact with that, so that the municipality in year one would realize over $1.1 million of net economic value, and going forward, the value would be as described. Now, you compare that with right now, currently, that property yields $51,000 total in taxes. However, beginning in 2015, that property will be farmland assessed. There's nothing we can do about that. That's state law. And so that property would be generating $2,000 in revenue. So I guess whether the economic benefit is significant or not is in the eye of the beholder, but those are the numbers. In terms of the settlement terms, a couple of points that I'd like to make, and I think the easiest way to describe this is to go through sort of chronologically the way the settlement would unfold. The first is that any settlement agreement entered into would be contingent upon Parsippany's open space application being granted by the Morris County Open Space Committee and approved by the freeholders. If that doesn't happen, if their application is not granted, then Parsippany, assuming that the settlement agreement is approved and signed, and Parsippany doesn't get the grant, then Parsippany would be able to cancel the settlement agreement and there would be no settlement. In terms of the timing of that, we submitted the application. We have had a lot of interaction with the county professionals who have had a lot of questions and so forth. In fact, they're planning a site visit, I think, in the not-too-distant future. The Open Space Committee meets in October, and they make their open space awards typically in the second week or so of November. So the grant awards will be made relatively quickly, and so we should know, you know, pretty soon whether or not we're going to be able to get that grant. Assuming that the grant is awarded to Parsippany, then within 60 days after the awarding of the grant, Parsippany would have to consider an ordinance to rezone the property. And the rezoning of the property would be to rezone the, again, that 9.26 acre uplands piece, which is the subject of the open space application. That would be rezoned to open space. And the lower 17.38 acres would be zoned for up to 152,000 square feet of commercial. There are restrictions on that. Again, it would be basically five buildings. There would be a 48,000 square foot building, which would be the Whole Foods supermarket. By the way, we continue to be assured that Whole Foods continues to be under lease and is interested in the property, and we will be continuing to get further confirmation of that, but there's no reason to believe otherwise, and in fact we've affirmatively been assured that Whole Foods is still desirous of being at the site and that the lease is still in effect. There would be another building of up to 40,000 square feet, but the tenants would not be able to exceed 20,000 square feet each. Again, so you'd have 48,000 square feet, which would be Whole Foods. You'd have another building of 40,000 square feet, but the maximum tenant size for any one tenant would be 20,000 square feet. Then there would be a building not to exceed 28,000 square feet and a building not to exceed 32,160 feet, with, and in that building, no single unit exceeding 20,000 square feet, and there would have to be a minimum of three tenants in that building. And then there would be one pad, which is contemplated as a bank pad, of a little over 1,300 square feet. Now, significantly, and Ed, in a moment when he shows you the plan, you'll be able to see exactly what I'm describing to you. There would be a deed restriction. The settlement agreement would be recorded with the clerk's office, and there's language in there that that makes the settlement agreement a deed restriction with regard to these limitations that I just described, so that the developer couldn't come back and go to the planning board and say, oh, we'd like, you know, 35,000 square feet for this tenant as opposed to 20,000. They couldn't do that. It's deed restricted. They couldn't go to the Board of Adjustment. They couldn't go and circumvent these restrictions. They'd have to come back to the governing body and have a vote before the governing body if they wanted to exceed those restrictions. So we've built those protections into the agreement. Restaurants would be a conditionally permitted use on the site. I think the thought was that if the site could attract some good restaurants, that would be a good thing. There is sufficient parking, but the reason why restaurants would be a conditionally permitted use is because typically in shopping centers you want to continuously evaluate the sufficiency of parking so that given the mix of particular uses, the parking works. I mean, if you had all restaurants, there may not be sufficient parking, which is why it's a conditionally permitted use. They'd have to come before the planning board, they'd have to make application, and the application would be reviewed to make sure that the parking worked for restaurants. After the zoning ordinance would be introduced, which again, if all goes according to the rough schedule that I've laid out here, that would be sometime in January, February, when it would be introduced. It would be referred to the planning board for recommendation, and then back to the governing body for second reading, which would likely be sometime in the March timeframe. I mean, you can, the months, they may be a little more, a little less time, but roughly around the March timeframe for second reading. And then there would be an obligation on the developer's part to make application to the planning board once the zoning ordinance is in place for an application within 90 days of the adoption of the zoning ordinance. The application would be for a preliminary site plan approval for the commercial space. I don't want to get overly technical, but they could make application for preliminary and final if they wanted to, but they have to make application for preliminary for the site plan. And they would also have to make application for preliminary and final subdivision so that 9.26 acre piece would be subdivided, and then the township would be able to close on that transaction. Now, after they get site plan approval, and I'm assuming that for purposes of this discussion, then they would have, the developer would have up to 7 months to do site clearing work. One aspect of the development that they need in order to effectuate the retail component of the project would be a grading easement in the back of the retail, which would encroach slightly into the open space piece. There was considerable discussion and interaction between my office, the developer, and the county in terms of what would be permitted. First of all, no structure would be permitted. They could not have a surface retaining wall, nor could they have a subsurface retaining wall in the open space parcel, in any part of the open space parcel. That would violate the rules of the open space trust, the open space grant, and so that couldn't happen. It is okay to have a grading easement. And in the grading easement, there would be some taking down of some trees so that an area could be graded, and then the soil would have to be stabilized with plantings. There would be no structures. But the clearing of trees could not occur post-closing on the acquisition of the property, because that would technically be a diversion under Green Acres and would trigger a very long, potentially expensive and complicated process to be able to get permission from the DEP to do the clearing. So the clearing that they would need within the grading easement area, and that grading easement area is delineated on the plan that Mr. Snikas will show you in a moment, would have to be done before any closing were to occur. And given the fact that they would likely to be ready to do that work during the winter months, and would be deferred to the spring. After a lot of negotiation, they would be given up to 7 months with extensions in order to be able to do the clearing work that they need to do. That will not adversely affect the county's open space grant, assuming that it gets it. Under the rules of the grant, municipality has 14 months within which to spend it, and then they're entitled to 2 6-month extensions. So if it takes 7 months for them to clear the site, it's not going to prejudice our ability to be able to close on the property once the clearing and the grading work is done. There is a grading plan that will be attached to and part of the settlement agreement, and any grading work that would be done on that property would be subject to planning board review and approval. And again, that's really just being done to stabilize the site, given the topography of the site, and is being done in lieu of any structures. Once the clearing work has been done, then the closing would occur, whereby the township would take title to the 9.26 acres in consideration of the sum of $3,500,000. That is the amount of money that the town has applied for from Morris County, and that amount has been agreed to by the developer. And I think at this point, Ed, it might be a good idea for you to show by way of illustration that which I described, and also, if you would, to provide a little bit more detail on the fiscal impact. Oh, one other point that I would like to make that I did forget. The Borough of Mountain Lakes governing body did pass a resolution supporting Parsippany's application to the Morris County Open Space Trust, and did so after collaborating on an administrative level with the township to ensure that that the buffers and the plan for the development of the site was acceptable to them.
Now, $135,000. And so, as Mr. Inglesino pointed out a moment ago, that's a total of about $1,162,672 in the initial year. In that estimate, as what I pointed out a moment ago, what's somewhat overestimated or conservatively estimated in the impacts to municipality is the gross revenue to the municipality is $127,901 from our estimates. What we factored out of that is a cost of $42,443 of cost with to the municipality to service such a facility, whether it's police, whether it's additional DPW needs, things of that nature. What that cost does, it sort of anticipates that impact to your tax rolls, and that's where the $85,458 came from when you subtract that impact of costs. Again, there's no school impacts as a result of the development. What we've also computed based upon the Rutgers multipliers is an increase in number of jobs of 229 additional jobs. And that's estimated from the multipliers. It may be more, it may be slightly less. And so with that, I'd like to just summarize by saying it does further those benefits that were pointed out a moment ago from the standpoint of the overall development. I'm sorry, due to the projector, it seems to be somewhat squeezing the site, but what you're seeing here is a substantial buffer, over 100 feet of buffer adjacent to Intervale Road, maintaining the integrity of existing trees. You have also a minimum of 290 feet of vegetated buffer plus future vegetated buffer, making a total of 388 feet. The buildings are set back away from the roadway, but yet they do provide a presence along Waterview. We are going to be requesting, and this will be through the site plan process, pedestrian connectivity, connections to mass transit, things of that nature as part of any site plan approval. And so with that, I turn it back to the council.
Mr. Inglesino, I'd like for you to advise the people that are here, as well as the residents, the rest of the residents in Parsippany, if the council were to vote down this agreement and not accept this agreement, what potentially could happen with this land?
Thank you, Mr. Council President. I'll try to address that. It's a very good question. The first way I'd answer it is to say that the only way to assure yourself that property will remain in its natural state is to acquire it or to gain a property right such as a conservation easement, in this case acquiring the property. If you don't acquire the property, then there is always the risk that the property will be developed. And then the question as you pose, is what are the potential forms of development that could occur on the property that would not comport with current zoning? Obviously, the property could be built out under its current zoning for office. It doesn't appear to be a market for that, and the likelihood of office being constructed on the property does not appear to be highly likely now or in the foreseeable future. There are two scenarios that I can see that may result in the possibility of undesired multifamily housing being developed on the property, two paths that I can foresee that would potentially yield that result. One has to do with affordable housing. The other has nothing to do with affordable housing. I think the path that has nothing to do with affordable housing is probably the more likely path that a potentially successful unwanted application would take. And that is if a developer were to file a use variance for multifamily housing. And again, this is not affordable housing related. This would just be a use variance or a D variance. In order to get a D variance by definition is a variance for a use that does not comport with your ordinance. Typically, in order to get a use variance, you have to show some consistency, some nexus between the use and the master plan for the municipality. Back in 2004-ish time period, the municipality made a determination to affirmatively exclude all multifamily housing from its master plan, which one could argue really creates an arguable lack of credibility for the master plan because it doesn't evaluate a particular site. It just basically says we don't want any multifamily in Parsippany. And that's unfortunate because there is no analysis in the master plan discussing this site as it would relate to multifamily housing. And when you look at the record that has been established in connection with this Waterview matter, both at the planning board and at the council developed last year, I would expect to hear arguments from the applicant quoting your own consultants and consultants for the applicants in terms of the suitability of multifamily on the site. It's transitional use between a residential neighborhood and the commercial corridor, for example. The fact that you would have consistent uses between multifamily residential and single family and multifamily residential catacorner to the site. And those arguments would undoubtedly be made in satisfaction of what they call the positive criteria for the D variance. Arguably, that may satisfy the positive criteria. I can't guarantee that it would. I can't guarantee that it wouldn't. I'm just telling you the arguments that would be made. But that's only half the battle for an applicant seeking a use variance. They would also have to show the negative criteria, meaning that there would be no negative impact on the community. One thing that you can't use legally to argue negative impact is number of school children. We all understand the strength of that argument politically, but legally that is not an argument that can be used. So the impact in terms of number of school children in a court of law to say that we're not going to permit a particular project because it's going to generate X number of school children is not a legal argument. Again, it's a political argument. And you're really left, based upon the record that I've reviewed below, as traffic is always an issue that would come up, although the challenge here would be that the traffic testimony that was given was that the traffic, there would be less impact, particularly during the peak hours from multifamily as opposed to an office use, and that would be the analysis. So, and that would obviously be, even if the Board of Adjustment were to turn down an application, those would be the arguments that you would expect to hear in court. And I don't think that it would be wise to discount those arguments to say that that they would never be upheld by a court. I don't want to say that they would definitely be upheld because I don't think that would be appropriate or responsible, but I also think that it would be irresponsible to discount those arguments, particularly in light of the record that has been developed below in this particular matter. So that's one path that you could see unwanted multifamily development on the site, particularly on the 9.26 acres. The other path involves affordable housing, and although that path may at some point in time be a more potent path, if you will, at this particular time, the affordable housing laws and process in New Jersey has really been in flux. What's happened with regard to affordable housing, and just very quickly, I think everybody's aware that under New Jersey law, every municipality has a constitutional obligation to provide its fair share of low and moderate income housing under the Mount Laurel Doctrine. And back in 1985, the state enacted the Fair Housing Act in response to the Builder's Remedy. And the Builder's Remedy is an important concept to understand, because under the Builder's Remedy, if a municipality has not met its constitutional requirement, then essentially developers have zoning as a matter of right to build multifamily housing anywhere it makes good planning sense in a municipality, irrespective of the zoning, so long as 25% of that development is set aside for low and moderate income housing. And it was really in response to the builder's remedy that the state back in 1985 finally enacted the Fair Housing Act and created the Council on Affordable Housing, known as COA, to both set requirements for a municipality and to administrate those requirements. And under the first two rounds of COA, each municipality was provided with a specific number of low and moderate income affordable housing units that it needed to satisfy or build in order to satisfy its constitutional requirement. And if and the deal was that the state made with the towns was, hey, if you submit an affordable housing plan to the state, to COA, that shows how you're going to satisfy your affordable housing obligation, then COA will essentially provide you with a shield against the sword of the builder's remedy lawsuit. You wouldn't be at risk for a builder's remedy lawsuit if you submitted your affordable housing plan and you got what they called substantive certification. That was a way municipalities could avoid builder's remedy lawsuits. And many municipalities, including Persephone, did exactly that. Well, Governor McGreevy came along and he realized that this whole COA thing was very unpopular with municipalities because people didn't like saying that, didn't like being told, municipalities didn't like being told that they had to provide X number of units, because it created unwanted, undesired development in municipalities. And so he had the idea that rather than assign each municipality a number, he would come up with a different methodology called growth share. And the concept was that the more you grow, the more you owe. If you as a municipality wanted to grow as a municipality, well, then with that growth came the obligation to provide more affordable housing. And that concept had some political appeal, except that it was challenged in court. And after many, many years, the New Jersey State Supreme Court, just this last September, almost a year ago, ruled that growth share as a methodology is unconstitutional. And the court said you have to go back to the methodology used in connection with the prior rounds, round one and round two, to come up with each municipality's real fair share number. The state has had an obvious reluctance to do that, and you may recall reading some press accounts last year that at one point the commissioner of the Department of Community Affairs may be found in contempt if the state didn't come out with regulations implementing the court's ruling, which back in June they did. Those numbers are very low, and I think by account of most of the all the planners that I've spoken to do not follow the round two, the prior round methodology for calculating fair share. Those regulations become effective in November after the rulemaking process. They've already been challenged. They're going to be challenged again. My view is they're likely, very likely, to be thrown out. And at that point, we can all speculate on what may happen. The court may re-implement the builder's remedy, which in my view would be very harsh on municipalities, but they could do that. If they did that, that would be another path in which you would lose control over the site, because under the builder's remedy, a developer would have the ability to come in and say, I want multifamily housing, and as long as 25% is set aside for low and moderate income housing, they would have that right. But in order to have that right, the court would have to re-implement the builder's remedy, which it hasn't done yet. The other thing that the court may do is appoint a special master to come up with each municipality's fair share based upon the methodology that the court ordered. I suppose that there's some political appeal to that. The state wouldn't be imposing it on municipalities, and municipalities wouldn't be imposing it on their residents. It would be the special master in the court. But I mean, that's reasonable. People can agree or disagree or speculate as to what the court may do. But that is another path whereby unwanted, undesired multifamily development could occur on the property. So the only way to really ensure that no development occurs on the property, and particularly we're talking about the 9.26 acres, is to buy it, and to buy it with open space money, because then it can never be developed. And we're at a point now where we have a handshake agreement and a fully negotiated document that would yield the benefits of the 9.26 acres being preserved forever, some commercial development along the Route 46 corridor, significant buffers and all the attributes of the plan that Mr. Snikas just described, and a positive fiscal impact for Parsippany taxpayers, which is significant or insignificant depending upon the eye of the beholder. And so I think that from a policy perspective, the governing body will have to obviously weigh those benefits that are achieved by settlement versus the potential uncertainty of the development of the site going forward. And also realizing that if we lose this developer, who is a contract purchaser, they don't own the property yet. If we lose this developer, then you lose Whole Foods and you lose the ability to put the genie back in the bottle, as it were. So those are sort of some of the legal and policy considerations. There are many and they are complex and there are nuances to them that that the governing body will have to consider. So I hope that answers your question, Mr. Council President. I tried the best I could.
Thank you. I just wanted the residents to know that there are two avenues that someone could take. One has to do with low-income housing, and then there's one that has nothing to do with that, where a developer could just come in and...
On a use variance.
On a use variance. Okay. Thank you. All right. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to open up a public hearing on this matter, and this matter only.
Make a motion.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Valori, seconded by Mr. Stanton. Roll call.
Mr. Peluso.
Yes.
Mr. Stanton.
Yes.
Mr. Valori.
Yes.
Mr. Carrifi.
Yes. Okay, at this time, you'll be given 3 minutes. Please come up, sign in, state your name and address.
Nicholas Homyak, Lake Hiawatha. I ask the council not to compromise in this lawsuit in the rezone. Following, no public need exists for this rezoning. RD and the property owner in themselves do not constitute a public need, and the value is a quality of life, not a tax rateable. A paper dollar. The character of the neighborhood has not changed to such an extent to justify rezoning. However, RD's plan will forever change it. Waterview Landscape is a threshold-enhancing original landscape that happens to be in an important groundwater recharge area affecting the future of water. It is a natural resource asset already working for us. In my humble opinion, the lawsuit is frivolous and should not be compromised because RD has not proven the need for rezoning in a public sense or in a regional sense. It's in a private sense. When a local governing board is presented a request to reclassify property from one zone to another, if there has been a change in a neighborhood and there is a public need therefore, evidence to support it should not be difficult to produce. To support an appeal, a reclassification of zones, the record at minimum should contain a map showing circumstances of the area, the changes in the neighborhood, statistics showing the public need, and such future matters of proof so that a rational, informed judgment can be formed so that the governing board consider that there is such proof there in the record to be concluded. None of that As a matter of fact, the citizens group has proven more so reasons not to rezone.
30 seconds, sir.
All right. A development is a qualitative improvement of circumstances, and that is something that develops the quality of the whole improves. And you can't tell me that these tax-ratable paper dollar things are going to improve anything for life here. And a basic principle of Anglo-Saxon common law is that no one should be unjustly enriched at the expense of another. And we're talking not open space, we're talking millions of dollars for a buffer zone. It's a joke, and it's an insult to the open space funding. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Sigmund Balaban, 10 Grecian Street, Parsippany. I found it interesting when the council president asked, what are the outcomes, what are the alternatives? And there were only two that were stated. In reality, there's three. The concept of winning in court, if you're up for the fight. I'm a little surprised the council, when you speak about what could happen in the future. You don't know what can happen in the future. You don't know what elected officials could have. If the future was set in cement, we wouldn't be here tonight, because things have been overruled in the past. We're being misled. Also, you say the numbers are conservative. Conservative by whose eye? I have no way of knowing that, and neither does the community. I think this thing should be rethought very carefully. I am listening to what is said, and with all due respect, I keep on thinking in my mind's eye of a commercial. I don't know what commercial it is, but it said that Pinocchio would not make a good public speaker. Thank you.
Sir, just one clarification. I think the council president asked in terms of paths for the development of the property. With regard to the current lawsuit, as I said, that lawsuit is pending. I remain highly confident that if the merits of that lawsuit are litigated, I'm very confident in the township's position with regard to that lawsuit. But that doesn't... that doesn't solve the problem. That doesn't mean that, you know, next week a developer can't come in for a use variance or can't come in to pursue multifamily housing through an affordable housing theory. It would just mean that we won the lawsuit, and by winning the lawsuit, we simply preserve the status quo, as it were.
Okay. Jonathan Nelson, 202 Patriots Road. I've lived in Parsippany almost 45 years, and one thing I know for certain is that every shopping center in Parsippany likes to file tax appeals. So even though that there's a net positive in years one, certainly with the hookup fees, and years two and other years, there's not a doubt in my mind that by year three, they will be filing a tax appeal. But the most important thing that I really have to say to the council, and what I really urge everybody in the audience, is to attend the freeholder meeting tomorrow night and let them know, or I hope you agree with me, that your displeasure of using open space money, although it's not Parsippany's, it is our tax money for the county, to buy, in essence, the buffer zone. Now, granted, it's not the entire buffer zone, but it's a majority of, or a good chunk of it, is buffer zone, that no matter what's built there, whether it be housing, whether it be an office building, whether it be a shopping center, can never be built, because there is a buffer zone. This is perfect timing for it, because if anybody knows Governor Christie, he likes to pick on Parsippany, and everybody remembers a few years ago when he called the superintendent the poster boy for greed, and that was for over $175,000 salary. Now, what does that have to do with this? The governor is opposed to using open space money, that's our tax money, really just to compensate this developer for lost profits of not building the townhomes. I'm not opposed to using open space money to purchase a whole lot if it was available for sale, but to use it for just for the buffer zone, where I can't see any enjoyment for the public, which is what this money is, other than for a few people who live directly behind it, and you're talking maybe three or four homes. That's, I don't see how people in Parsippany or Morris or Mountain Lakes or forget about the rest of the county could find that acceptable to use our open space money to purchase that back buffer. I think I'm running out of time, and that's all I have to say. Thanks.
Dave Kaplan, 263 Intervale, President of Citizens for Health, Safety, and Welfare. I'm speaking in both roles. As I've said every time I come up here, I own more property along this track than anyone else. So I'm deeply impacted by it. I've been doing this a long time. I started back in 2005 when there was a developer there. My son at the time was two. Someone from the Daily Record came and took a picture of my son playing by the Troy Brook overlooking the woods. He's in middle school now. It's been many, many years. And there were people in the neighborhood who fought this same kind of issue going back all the way to 1982, and I have all those documents from those agreements. So the history of this land is a funny one because everybody wants it. And I know you guys have worked very hard over the last few months since October to find something that is more palatable for us. There's no question that a lot of you have worked extremely hard on that. I do appreciate it, and I am sincere. And we may not always agree on some of the discussions, we may not agree on the outcome, but you guys work hard for us in that respect, and I do want to thank you for that. And you almost had me. I have to tell you, to be very frank, you almost had me until tonight when I heard about this 385-foot buffer, which then dropped to about a 300-foot buffer because we have to clear the land. And to me, the buffer was undisturbed, undisturbed, undisturbed. That was the beauty of it. And now we have to clear all these trees so that the undisturbed buffer is about 300 feet. The current zoning provides for a 200-foot buffer. So we're talking about 100 feet extra. That's not enough to destroy all of what's going to be destroyed on this. Mr. Snikas referred to the buffer along Intervale as substantial. Mr. Inglesino called it significant. It's 100 feet. Currently, it's 200 feet. So what has been called substantial and significant is reduced to what's currently there. It doesn't make sense. Yeah, you were close, but you lost me on the buffer issue. I just don't think that's right. Thank you.
Mr. Kaplan, if you could share with me the ordinance that shows the 200-foot buffer, I would appreciate it because we have looked and looked and looked. In fact, at first we were told that it was a deed restriction. We actually ordered title on the property and reviewed title. There is no deed restriction. The only thing that we were able to find was on an old map, there was a 200 notation made. But we have not been able to find an ordinance or a deed restriction, and I know there's nothing of record that establishes the 200-foot buffer. So if you have it, I would appreciate getting it because we haven't been able to confirm that. And I think the buffer here is it 300 or 388, Ed? 388 feet.
But 100 feet of clearing, right?
It's 388 feet before you get to the grading easement. Is that correct, Ed?
No.
388 feet total.
And about 100 feet of grading.
290 feet of undisturbed, okay. And then the rest would be in the grading easement, which would be disturbed, but it would be a grading easement, and there would be plantings and so forth, so that the soil would be stabilized. But as far as the 200 feet, if you have it, I would appreciate getting it because that would certainly help us.
Yeah, I will obviously look for that. Currently, are we at about 200 feet with the? You're not laughing at me, are you? Looks like you're laughing at me. We're 200 feet now between the current existing offices and the properties. Do you know? is the current buffer of the existing buildings, all those offices, 200 feet between those offices and the housing.
Ed, you want to address that?
At least to the track that's to the east of the site, it's approximately 200 feet in the minimum distance.
Which I think it's a setback.
But it's more of a setback. It's not a preserved buffer. It's a setback requirement.
Setback meaning setback to the building, so there could be parking and land disturbance within that 200 feet area.
Not a lot of full parking.
I'm Steve Arnold. I live at 4 Craven Road, Mountain Lakes, which is just at the upper left corner of the map. I have in front of me the POD ordinance. I wish that the attorney could read the POD ordinance. Buffer requirement. A buffer width averaging 200 feet with a minimum width of 150 feet shall be required along all Intervale Road frontage. And any boundary of the tract which coincides with the residential zone boundary, except where such boundary coincides with a state or United States highway. Please, read the ordinance. Now, I also don't understand how there can be a presentation about some development now, last year, the year before, and there's never a presentation of what could be developed as it is now. What are the limits? The ordinance limits the gross floor area. It limits it to 1.3 million square feet, which is 0.226 ratio. There's already been developed 1.2 million square feet. There's only room for 78,000 square feet, according to the ordinance. The ordinance requires that there be no more than 45% development, that there be at least 55% open space. Open space, 55% is required. I would like to see where is that open space on the whole property. 55% equals 80 something acres. Please, do your job. Have your planning person, who is really ignorant on this, develop the list of what's been developed. What is the square footage that's been developed? What is the buffer, the open spaces that have been dedicated that are required? And then come to us and talk about it. In 2007, there was a study by Stewart Associates for a development that Embassy Suites wanted to do. They were doing it because they were concerned that they would exceed the limits for the whole tract. And they just wanted to do a little expansion on Embassy Suites. But they thought maybe there's not enough room. Well, the study was done and it found, yeah, they could put on another 20,000 square feet or something like that. 20,000 square feet. Not 150,000 square feet. The whole zone does not allow.
Sir, that. 30 seconds.
Okay. Please have the planning person, have your borough engineer do the studies, calculate, find out what has been developed, what the limits are, and what is allowed. You don't need to fight this lawsuit. You have it in your hands right now. It's all open space already. Just get it done.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, do you have an extra? Is that an extra copy of that? Could you give that to our clerk or
give you the POD ordinance? Come on, it's Article 22. It's paragraph 430-150. It's your ordinance.
Okay, maybe Mr.
I don't know what he's reading, but if you could give us a copy of it, I'd appreciate it.
Hi, Ed Chu, 53 Forest Drive. I just have a couple questions. So with this, I guess the settlement item here is, if it's accepted by the council, I guess, it assumes a lot of things, right? It means that you're already going to rewrite the master plan. You're going to actually, you're required now then to pass rezoning as well. So basically, with the settlement, they've already forced the town council to accept rezoning as part of the conditions. So there will be no review sessions, no rewriting of the ordinances. It's going to have to pass as is. Is that correct?
No, it's not exactly correct. If they pass the settlement agreement, then they would be forced to consider the rezoning in a manner that's consistent with the settlement agreement. So, in other words, legally, you can't require, that would be contract zoning. So as a settlement, we wouldn't say that as a settlement, they would be required to pass the zone. They could conceivably enter into the settlement agreement, consider the zoning, and decide they don't want to go forward at that point. They would still go through the rezoning process. I think that it is fair to assume that there is a pretty high degree of likelihood that if the settlement agreement passes, that they would likely implement the terms of the settlement agreement, which would include rezoning. But first of all, they would have to go through the rezoning process. So there would have to be a zoning ordinance prepared, and that zoning ordinance would have to go through the ordinary process of introduction and first and second reading and so forth.
Okay. That's basically my questions, because it's a lot of, could you actually detail in terms of the settlements and the points that you were brought, you were required to sort of bring to the table and sort of meet those conditions as part of the settlement. What are still steps that have to be made in order for this entire plan to be sort of to move ahead? So for example, you're talking about how the housing was, how they could go either way with the housing if you don't accept the settlement. What other things have to be accepted by us and by the town, or as part of these conditions in terms of, for example, rezoning needs to be now go through due process? What other items have to be accepted or are still sort of conditional? If you can do that.
Okay. Do you have anything further?
No, that'll be it. Okay. I'm still collecting information. I can't really make any comments until I get more information on this.
Okay. That's fair. Again, even if the settlement agreement is approved, there would still be a fair number of steps that would have to be taken in order to implement it. One is, as I indicated, that getting the grant award from the county would be a contingency. So if the settlement agreement were entered into and the town didn't get the grant from the county, then the town would have the ability to walk away from the settlement agreement. The settlement agreement would require the town to consider, the governing body to consider, an ordinance that would implement the terms of the settlement agreement, which I described and which Mr. Snikas illustrated to you. But the council would still have to take the votes on those ordinances. If they decided not to take the vote on those ordinances, then they wouldn't be implementing the settlement agreement. So there are still a lot of steps that would have to be taken, but I think we've outlined pretty much all of the relevant conditions and actions that would have to be taken in order to implement it. In that zoning ordinance, again, it would zone the top piece as open space, the 9.26 acres, and then the bottom 17.38 acres would be zoned commercial in a manner consistent with what you've seen tonight in the presentation. And then after the zoning ordinance is implemented, then the developer would have to go through and do its clearing and get its approvals, et cetera. So there are still a lot of steps that would have to be taken. If at any time, let's say the developer lost a lease with Whole Foods and couldn't finance the project, well then, it would be, I think, difficult to really implement the full part of the deal at that point. But don't forget, we would at that point have achieved having the upper 9.26 acres at least zoned for open space, which it's not zoned for today.
Good evening. I'm John Pritchard. I live at 11 Glen Road. I have a couple of questions. One question being, what is the time frame and schedule over which the public will have an opportunity to review this? And so when will the governing body vote on whether to accept this settlement agreement? My second question is, will the settlement agreement and associated documents be provided to the public ahead of the time that the governing body considers approving it? And my third question is, considering that counsel has described some confidence in winning the lawsuit, but said that in the long term we have to deal perhaps with the New Jersey Supreme Court and what they may do even years from now, my third question is, wouldn't it be better for the people of this town to win the lawsuit, show the developer that you've won the lawsuit, and then negotiate? Could you please respond to my three questions? First one being, what's the time frame under which the public will have an opportunity to consider this, and when would the governing body vote on the settlement document?
Sure. There is a time issue here in the sense that we have a pending application before the county. So I think that the council president certainly has afforded folks the opportunity to comment tonight, and there can certainly be an additional meeting to do that in the near future. I would advise that by the end of this month that the council make a determination as to whether or not it wants to move forward with the settlement or not, because otherwise it will likely negatively impact the application up at Morris County for the open space grant. You know, the time is now, not necessarily tonight, but certainly this month, and I'm sure the council president can elaborate a little more in terms of what he may have in mind in terms of a time frame in that regard. In terms of the settlement document being provided to the public, I've provided copies to the governing body tonight. It's not going to be public now because I'd like to get the input from my clients on the document and answer any questions that they have. And if the council decides that it wants to make the document public before a vote is taken, they can certainly do that. I wouldn't advise doing that yet because it's still a deliberative document. And I want to get the comments from the governing body before it's in quote unquote final shape. And lastly, again, I do have confidence in winning the lawsuit. But again, this developer, RD Realty, right now is a contract purchaser. And although I can't predict what RD Realty may or may not do, my point is simply that they may just go away. But that doesn't mean that another developer won't reemerge in the future and propose, you know, something else for the site that may be much less desirable in the grand scheme of things. And I don't want folks to be of the opinion that just because the property isn't zoned to permit, say, multifamily housing, that automatically means that multifamily housing can never be developed on the site, because I think that there are risks in that regard, so we don't want to be here at some future point in time wondering, you know, how multifamily development is being developed on the site when that's not the desired result for the community. If you buy the property, that portion, that 9.26 acres, then you have assurance that it will never be developed. That's the only way to guarantee that property will never be developed.
Okay, so should I understand your recommendation to the council is that this settlement agreement not be made public tonight or until it's reached some other finalization in the future, and then that the council as a governing body should vote on it before the end of this month, which we've got 3 weeks left?
Yep.
Is that, maybe I should direct it to the council members whether the governing body members think that that's fair to treat these people that way, where you're not even going to show what the actual settlement document says on the recommendation of your council, yet Evidently, his advice to you is that you go forward and vote on this before the end of September. Please let me know. Is this what the members of the governing body think is fair to the public?
Sir, as of right now, what we're doing is we're having this meeting here so that everyone that's in attendance could see what is proposed.
No, but you're not willing to show. Let me know.
Okay.
Can you show us the document? You've got copies of it.
Can I have a copy
so I can... Sir, as of this time, our council's attorney, our town's attorney, has advised us that we cannot do that at this time.
You cannot. That is, you're not allowed to? Does the law prohibit you?
Sir.
Your Honor, pardon me. Council members, there's people here, they have an organization. They print up T-shirts. They hire lawyers. They do their studies. We've got a guy who looks at all the statutes and obviously spends time in his attic looking at this. And now you're going to rush this through before those people can find out what the document actually says that you choose not to allow us to
see. Sir, first off, your time is up. I want to assure you.
Does anybody have something?
Sir, I want to assure you that we are not rushing through anything. If you attended.
3 weeks is rushed.
Sir, your time is done. If you attended any of the previous meetings, you know of all people, I myself did not rush to any judgment. I listened to the people. I listened to everyone that came to those meetings, and I voted accordingly. Okay, so I would like to state that for the record. Okay, we are not rushing into anything. I am just.
Will there be a vote before the end of September? Well, how about you give us time? How about you give us time to look at the document that we are not allowed to see, which you have chosen not to allow us to sit.
Okay, sir, first, your time is up, okay?
Okay.
I will assure you that we will not rush into anything before we listen to what everyone in the audience, everyone in the town has to say about this matter. I will assure you of that.
Well, right now, we don't have any faith in what you're doing, proceeding with, because
we say your name and address?
Sure. Diana McElroy, 37 Intervale Road. Just by my address alone, you could tell that I'll be impacted greatly. We have no confidence right now in that you will listen to us because we thought this matter was settled. Last time you voted on this, the mayor came out saying, we want to buy the land. I'm with you. Let's do the right thing. Now we're right back to square one, okay? As the town attorney, forgive me because I'm ignorant in these matters, I thought you worked for us as well, okay? So I thought what you knew, we should know. Am I incorrect? Do my tax dollars not pay your salary? Are they who you work for? No, I think it's the town. And the town is here to tell you that we're not happy with this. We'd rather go with the lawsuit, win, and if another developer comes along, first off, it'll be many years before another developer comes along if we win outright. We'll fight it again. We don't want this to happen, and we're trying to tell you that. What is wrong with trying to purchase the whole land? Like, and have open space. There is another option. You're giving us these two options, and I personally think you're trying to scare us. And we're not going for it. We're trying to tell you, make it stop.
Ma'am, did you sign in?
I did.
Excuse me, Pepper Doctor, 182 Hawkins Avenue. I'd just like to remind the council to take your time on this. First of all, we are having the same kind of, not outright threats, but things that could happen, what we're being told can happen and everything like that. COA, we hear about COA all the time. Multifamily, we don't want to see it, but you know what? It's been happening. And it's going to continue to happen, so don't kind of BS the town. Okay, we want to stop that too. But right now, the woman before me just made me laugh because this is exactly what I was going to say. When you had this meeting, when you voted, the mayor said we were going to go after and purchase this property. With open space money, not a little portion of it, He was going to look at the entire thing. Okay? Now, I've said this before. When you are changing or you're doing something that there is ordinances on, it is your responsibility to make sure we have every ordinance that's going along with something. We should be checking what ordinances are out there before we go into any kind of settlements with anybody. I mean, how naive is that? I want to know from each council member sitting up there tonight that you can tell me, in all honesty, that you understand exactly everything that was said tonight, that you understand about these buffers, these yardage, this and that. Okay? I don't want you guys making mistakes. We've had plenty of them already. We don't need any more. I am asking you to think carefully, to give it the consideration it needs, and to remember your promises. To remember your promise to take care of the township and the residents that live within it.
30 seconds.
I just want to know that you exactly understand everything that you were told from 6:30 on till tonight. You retained everything and know exactly that this is up and up. I myself believe, like everybody else, you should go forward with the lawsuit and do not do any of this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jim Heisen, Two Littlewood Court, Mountain Lakes. Two questions. One, at the next meeting, could we have some comments back on whether or not this ordinance requires 200 feet on Intervale Road? I'm quite confused. I hear yes, I hear no. And if we could just get some clarification on that for the next meeting, because obviously, I guess we don't, know tonight.
Sir, you're talking about the way it's currently zoned.
Current zoning, yes. I think I heard tonight one person saying he felt it was 200 feet and outlined and quoted in an ordinance. Secondly, this issue of when we left last October and the council voted down the proposal, it was offered that there would be an attempt to purchase all of this land as open space. And I wonder if we could get some feedback as to what was done to try and pursue that and why that hasn't worked out.
My name is Ken Urema. I live at 41 Wine.
Wait, hold on.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
That would have to be addressed by the administration.
Yeah, I mean, let me just, first of all, there was a lawsuit filed after that, and any thing that occurred in connection with the lawsuit, we're not going to discuss. What we are discussing is sort of the tentative settlement that was reached subject to council approval.
Go ahead, sir.
Okay. After the no vote on RD Realty in October, I formed a committee of residents and I met with them. That's why you have to let me finish. I didn't interrupt anybody when they spoke, so please give me the opportunity. I met with the committee and we discussed open space. But then RD Realty sue the town, put a lawsuit against the township. Therefore, I could not have any more meetings with them. I explained it to some of the committee members. They knew ahead of time. One's actually sitting in the audience tonight, that I couldn't proceed to speak about it from that point on, and what we were prepared to do, because I could not, because the township was sued. I wanted to, but I couldn't, under the recommendation of our council and the fact that RD Realty was suing the town. And I didn't want to put the town in harm's way in any way. So I said that once we get further on and I'm allowed to speak, I will meet with the committee once again. Thank you.
Ken Urema, 41 Winding Way. Can I find out how many parking spaces there are?
Yeah, I'm sorry I didn't cover that. I meant to. They are proposing 723 parking spaces, and when you apply the parking standards of the municipality currently, it requires 663.
Okay.
So there's actually more parking.
Okay, and are there truck facilities for delivery in the back behind that clearing area?
Yeah, no, not back behind the clearing. It's next to the back of the building. It will be just in the back of the building. There is a roadway that circulates on the back of the building.
Okay, thank you. One other question. Do we happen to know what other stores might be put in there? Or would it be something that would be like a 24/7 type situation? Or we have no idea. We know possibly Whole Foods, but not anything else other than the bank.
To the best of my knowledge, that has not been addressed as far as whether or not there's going to be a 24-hour operation at that location.
Okay, thank you. I typically don't come up to talk about these things, but I really kind of think that if the township tried a little bit harder to fill some of the vacant buildings and spaces that are lining 46 and Route 10, maybe it wouldn't be so necessary to look to new development for ratables. There's a lot of, and who's to say a store, one of these stores, these facilities won't close up in 2 years, just like so many others have on 46. There's just so many open, available spaces that could be used and just, but no, why bother? Let's just build another one. Now, also, I'd like to say that I understand fully, Council, the gag order, so to speak, that was put on everybody. That it was essentially, for lack of a better phrase, was kind of a gag order. Nobody could talk about it. Having said that, now we, the public, are kind of like being squeezed because of this so-called gag order that was put into effect. You guys couldn't talk about it, we couldn't hear about it, and now it's coming out with a very short time span to review it. And I've got a little bit of a problem with that. Thank you.
Sir, first of all, there's no aspect of the proposed contemplated settlement that was not shared with you all tonight. There's been
Excuse me, sir, that's not my point.
Yeah.
My point is for the last 7, 8, whatever, how many weeks from the point that the developer filed suit, no one could talk about it. So if I ran into Mr. Carrefi and just asked him, how he couldn't talk about it because you advised the council, no one can talk about it, and I understand that. But now when you can talk about it, we're all being given a very narrow window to analyze it, see what it's going to do to our community, and to respond to it. It would have been nice, the amount of time that you guys couldn't talk about it, we could have now that time to review it. That's my point.
And that's a fair point. Unfortunately, the litigation process is a litigation process. I indicated before that I thought we were striving to have some decision made this month because we're concerned about the potential for negative impact on the open space application with the county. We're going to have to go back in light of some of the comments and see, you know, what sort of latitude and what the real dates are in that regard, because nobody wants to, you know, force somebody to make a decision if they don't feel fully informed, or if the public isn't fully informed. Obviously, folks can agree to disagree, but you certainly want confidence in the decision-making process in terms of information being available and an ample opportunity to consider it. You know, we have a lot of balls in the air, and the county decides these applications when they decide them, and so that is a factor that we have to be aware of in terms of the time. But I didn't want to leave you with the impression that there's a hard and fast, you know, you have to decide by the end of September. I think we have to decide sooner rather than later. I know the committee meets in October to review the applications. In light of the discussion here tonight, we'll go back and get further clarification on, you know, more exact time frames
That would be really good, because we'd all have an opportunity to further review it. And I'm sure with the way you sit, I mean, your connections and your influence, you could probably make those arrangements for us on our behalf. Thank you.
Good evening, Rhonda Pritchard, 11 Glen Road. I had two questions, actually, and a comment. I think I want to make my comment first. I have lived in the township for 27 years now, and my feeling about the community has not changed. In fact, it has deepened. I moved here from the South because I wanted to live in a great community that had great values and standards to uphold. And I just feel like that for $85,000 to tear down all these trees and to build something that we don't even need, why are we even entertaining such a thing? If it's in our master zoning plan, we have to, can we not uphold that? Okay, my question is, and it's possible that the mayor answered this at least partially, is I wanted to know, why didn't the Open Space Committee meet? And I am just curious as to, you know, this buffer zone that will be bought, the 9 acres from the Open Space Fund, it seems like that will basically go to the developer. Has it been done to ask the county to buy the entire package and not just have this money basically go to the buffer, which will benefit the developer? Those are my questions.
I'm sorry. Miss, I didn't catch your name. Could you repeat the question part of it?
Yes. I wanted to know why didn't the Open Space Committee meet, and has it been considered to ask the county to purchase the entire property and not just the buffer, which will basically benefit the developer?
Oh, no. The application to the county was for the 9.26 acres. Now, mind you that. The capability for development on that 9.26 acres, I mean, the property could hold. I'm not saying there's a right to develop it, but you could lay out a development that would yield 60 units, Ed? 60 units that would sort of comply with your existing ordinances in terms of density, would comply with the residential site improvement standards with regard to road widths, turning radiuses, and things of that nature. So it's not an insignificant piece of land in terms of size and in terms of its potential yield for development. So I did want to make that point, but the application was made for the 9.26 acres. Again, that really sort of bore out of prospective settlement discussions, and we had at for that property, we had a willing seller. We did not have a willing seller for the entirety of the site. RD Realty is not the owner of the property currently. They're the contract purchaser. And our settlement is with RD Realty. If RD Realty were to lose its contract with the owner, then that's another thing that could go wrong and completely derail any prospect of a settlement, and we haven't had any discussions directly with the property owner, because RD is the contract buyer. So they were certainly not entertaining the notion of buying the entirety of the site. So the short answer to your question is, we only had a willing seller for the 9.26 acres.
Can I ask one question? Okay, so currently, I thought that the property was currently zoned only for mixed or for office buildings. So that's currently, so for anybody to come in and say they wanted to build something else, you know, it just, that's just my point of confusion, I guess.
Thank you.
Ann Jeton, 34-Arch Drive. I've got several questions. I'll read them all first, then you can answer them. First question is, I'm really confused about what the real value of this property is. It's taxed at a value where it only produces $51,000 in rateables. Next year, it's going to go to be a tree farm under state law and only give us $2,000. Yet, for this 9.6 acres, we're willing to spend $3.6 million? It's very confusing. I don't understand how. I'd like to sell you my house, all right, for that? Buy my house for open space. I'd like to make a nice profit, too, based upon how these numbers are being thrown out. I'm confused about that. The other thing I'm confused about is the benefit to the town. Is that based upon full occupancy or just Whole Foods? Because what if they build it, only Whole Foods go in and everything else is empty? What's the benefit then? Because we have a ton of empty retail space as it is now. What makes you think that that stuff would have any tenants in it, other than Whole Foods, who's currently under contract? The other questions I have are, I'm confused at how, if this goes through, this isn't spot zoning and doesn't open up potential zoning requests from the adjacent business office buildings. When their tenants are all moving out and they don't have any tenants and they say, hey, I want retail just like them, how are you going to say, no, we can't do that? Have you thought about that and how this will spread like a virus between those buildings and the ones on Cherry Hill Road and everywhere else around Parsippany if this goes through? Those guys right there have as much right to profitability on their land ownership as that guy right there. And that's going to be their argument. And then I have the stores, the question of what type of stores, like, what, have you thought about that? Is it going to be liquor stores 24/7, that type of stuff? And that would be it. So what's the real value of the property? What's the benefits to the town? Full occupancy, just Whole Foods? How are you going to stop this virus from spreading to the current adjacent property owners who have vacancies up the wazoo? And what type of stores? Think about that, too.
Okay.
So who wants to go first?
Let me take a stab at some of these because I've been sitting in these meetings and have a fair amount of experience in real estate. In terms of the type of stores, we certainly contemplate and have had discussion with RD that when the zoning ordinance, if and when there's a zoning ordinance, that there would be a very high quality, upscale level of architectural design and public features to the site that will really make the site an attractive site for upscale kind of tenants. And Whole Foods in their lease has some rights with regard to who the tenants would be in the site. And Whole Foods, as I understand it, and as we've been told, there are certain sort of types of tenants that like to gravitate towards Whole Foods because they find synergies with each other in terms of attracting people to the center. So the concept is that if you bring in an upscale tenant like a Whole Foods, that you will attract, particularly given the landscape and design architecture of the buildings, that you would attract other upscale type of tenants. That's the retail theory there. And as you said, Whole Foods.
And those type of stores won't go to the other vacancies in Parsippany because they're not upscale.
Well, it's again, your Whole Foods is the draw. So if you have an anchor like a Whole Foods, you're going to be attracting people to the Whole Foods, and other tenants want to benefit from that traffic that is there from the Whole Foods. So that's the retail.
The draw. Whole Foods is the draw for other tenants. Other,
yes, yeah, that's yes. That's the retail dynamic of what goes on. And I say Whole Foods has some veto rights in their lease, That's not with the town, but that's at the center and the developer. They have some veto rights in the lease in terms of tenants that they may not want to see mm-hmm. there. So that's the retail dynamic on that question. In terms of spot zoning, this is an issue that that we addressed, I think, pretty significantly back in October with regard to the prior proposal. It's an issue that we have addressed at length internally with our planner, and we feel very confident that if somebody were to challenge the zoning on a spot zoning basis, we feel very confident that we would prevail in that lawsuit. We don't believe that this is an instance of spot zoning. In regards to the impact that a rezone may have on other properties, it's really hard to say. My experience, both on the municipal side and as somebody who's represented property owners, is that the market typically drives the request for the rezoning. So, if you had tenants that want to move into vacant buildings and the uses for those tenants are not permitted, that's usually the impetus for, or the reason why, the driving force why those property owners will then approach the town for rezoning. Also, if there are trends developing in a particular area, real estate trends that are developing in a particular area, that may also trigger the need for rezoning. But typically, it's a market sort of driven force
right.
that will...
The request for this rezoning is due to the market, that office buildings isn't profitable. Those are office buildings. So
right.
therefore, the connection to me would be, if they're not making money, they're going to ask for the same thing if this is successful. And then this turns into a strip mall, not a little tiny one, but a strip mall, because it will just spread.
Well, again, the Whole Foods is really the driver here for this particular location. Once Whole Foods is here and in that location, then there aren't any other, I don't know who the more upscale, what kind of tenant would be that would drive further type of requests. But in any case,
does the council believe that there is the potential that this could spread if this is successful and those companies are losing business and you're not getting tax readables and you want to raise taxes, so you're more willing to let that also happen on the other acres? That's reasonable. It's reasonable, like it could be low-income housing, and reasonable that this existing lot can become multifamily. It's just as reasonable, isn't it?
Well, the market...
I mean, nobody knows what the future holds.
No, but the
so
market...
it could go anyway.
The market right now, for example, I'll give you the big example of big box. I mean, it's not as if the town is just going to say yes to anything. I mean, there was a lot of discussion about...
That's now. 5 years from now, they could say yes because that was successful and they're not making any tax ratables off those office buildings if they're vacant. So this could set a precedence to what could spread as a virus and turn us into a Route 10. That's highly feasible. It's not out of the question, right? Everyone agrees? That could happen, right? All right.
The other, in terms of the value of the property, and let me preface my remarks by saying you're probably not going to like what I'm going to say.
Just so you know, ma'am, your time is up, so.
Yeah, I know, I'm just
going to let him answer
okay.
that.
Okay. I'm giving it to you straight. You may not like what I have to say. We have submitted an appraisal to the county, which sets what we believe is a value on the property by our appraiser. In fact, we've had discussions with the county attorney as to whether or not that appraisal is operable or not, whether or not you can get that appraisal through OPRA. There's been some discussion about that. The view is that at the moment, that appraisal is what they call a deliberative document, and so you could not get it through OPRA. At this particular point, in my view, that would change if a settlement agreement is entered into. Then I think the appraisal becomes subject to public view. Or if the discussions regarding the settlement terminate, at that point, in my view, the appraisal becomes open to public view. The reason why we believe, and I'm not the only one who believes this is also the view of the county lawyer, at the moment why it's a deliberative document is because it relates to the purchase price. We're in a business negotiation with the developer to establish a price at $3.5 million, which we believe is a sustainable value, is a good value, and we have a handshake on that. If theoretically there was an appraisal that showed a much higher value, maybe the developer comes back and says, "Oh, no, 3.5. No, we want more." So, or if it's less, it probably wouldn't work the other way because the developers always want more. But the point is that it may prejudice our business negotiation to publicly disclose the appraisal at this particular moment. Again, if a settlement is entered into, I believe that changes and the appraisal becomes public, available to the public. If the settlement agreements terminate and we're not going to go in and do the settlement deal as outlined, then at that point, my view is the appraisal becomes subject to public review. So I can't comment on the value as it relates to the appraisal. I guess I was a little long-winded in getting to that point. But. That's a good question, and that's not a new question. I forgot it. There are a lot of different ways in which property can be valued. One way for different purposes. For purposes of valuation for acquisition, it would be valued as highest and best use. That's different from what a tax assessor can assess a property for. And of course, that issue really becomes moot because once they do the farmland assessment, it really doesn't matter. If they qualify under the farmland assessment, then it's farmland assessed. And that's where you get to the $2,000 a year.
Good, sir.
My name is Sri Menon, 6 Pine Tree, please. This is not a question, Mr. Valuri, Mr. Karifi, and Mr. Peloso. Last year, around this time, based on your sentiments, a lot of us here have worked really hard for you three people. So when it comes time for you to vote, I hope that you'll actually vote for us. Thank you.
From 69 Forest Drive. My question really is that for a lawsuit that we believe we are confident that we will win if it goes through, but because of this lawsuit, if we are not able to follow our plans or our intent, and we are going to settle like this, we are opening our floodgates for many such lawsuits, aren't we? Right, what is it? It's a lawsuit that we are confident we are going to win, but because of this lawsuit, we are letting go on our intent of, you know, making this as an open space, and we are settling by acquiring, you know, the buffer space with open space money and settling like this. Then, many developers will find it very easy then to sue Pasipani and get a deal that they want. We should not do it as a part of settlement. I don't mind as an agreement. I just can't do it. That's my
point. Okay. In terms of the lawsuit, again, I have expressed and continue to express confidence in the township's position. But I'm the lawyer representing the township. I'm not the judge, so I don't make the decision. In any litigation, there is always a degree of risk in the outcome of a case. I guess in terms of a risk factor, we should add that, although I do believe that the paths for undesired development that I outlined before, namely the use variance and in the future, potentially affordable housing. I don't view that as a risk at this particular moment, but in the future I do. I think those are much more, I think those are pose much more significant risks to development of the property than the current lawsuit. But that's just my assessment. The fact is that there are risks, and the fact is that the only way to ensure that the property won't be developed is to buy it. There's no other way to make it 100%.
I agree to that. All I'm saying is that we are doing it as a settlement for the case, which is what other developers will find it easy, you know, to follow as a route to get what they want. That's all.
Hi, I'm Jackie Bay from Morris Avenue in Mount Lakes. I have some questions just about this for Mr. Snikas. If I understand this correct, the dark green is the 9.26 acres, but that dotted line that runs along there is where it can be graded. Is that correct?
That's correct. And what I'll point to now is the dotted line. The dotted line's here, and again, it was about 100 feet of distance. And there's about a 15-foot area of grading easement on this side.
But that, there's a dotted line at the whole bottom of that stretch on Intervale, right? That whole bottom third is below the dotted line.
This area here?
Yes.
Yes, there is an area of area for grading at
okay.
this corner.
So that's a third, roughly, of the Intervale border that's available for grading.
I couldn't say that.
Well, I'm just guessing. But so tell me, what does grading mean? Because I know that the Doremus Ridge is really high. I think the highest elevation is like 380 feet. Mm-hmm. So are we talking terraces? Are we talking slopes? Are we talking leveling? What is grading?
Okay, what grading is that they're looking to, in the back area of the building, they're looking to establish a grade or a slope of 1:3. And what that means is for every 3 feet of horizontal, you go 1 foot vertical. And the reason for that is that that's a maintainable slope. You can get out in there with a mower or
can
other vehicles.
Can you get closer to the mic?
Oh, excuse me. And other vehicles in order to maintain that slope. Now, what they don't need on this side is that extensive area of grading because they're trying to minimize the amount of retaining walls in the back of the building. What they've done on the westerly side is a series of retaining walls to avoid that grading into the slopes, but it has to do with the transition of grade across the property from Route 46, the permissible grades that are permitted in front of a retail center for ADA access and things of that nature.
So where are those retaining walls? In the light green section? I only care about Intervale Road.
Mm-hmm.
In the light green section?
Yes, they would be in the light green area, and that's on their property. That's
and
on that
tall?
On that 17.38
how
acres.
How tall are those retaining walls?
Those retaining walls range from, I believe, 4 feet high, and I'm not exactly certain of this, to about, I believe it's 7 or 8 feet high.
Okay.
And they're terraced as well, so there's one wall above another wall.
Terraced retaining walls, and the maximum height is 8 feet.
Approximately.
Okay.
Because this is a concept at this point.
So the grading below on the, well, I'm calling it a third of Intervale Road where they're grading it, it's sloped, this 1:3 idea, and they're going to replant it with trees to stabilize it, or bushes or something, vegetation.
The area you're referring to is the area closest to Route 46,
yes.
That area there.
The
that is actually not going to be graded at 1:3. That's actually a much more gradual slope in that location because it's closer to Route 46. And as I mentioned a moment ago, as you get deeper into the site, because of this, the slope that they need for the retail center, that's where they have to grade up at a greater slope towards the back of the site. But on Intervale Roadside, they don't need it here. That's actually going to be rather level grading. That's to facilitate this adjacent parking area. Then the retaining walls start approximately here and wrap up to the back corner.
So when you say level, that means that bottom third is going to be pretty much flat.
I can't say flat. It will be sloped, but it won't be as steeply sloped as the back of 1:3.
Okay, so then it's fair to say that there will be no existing trees, no mature trees in that bottom third.
I can't say the bottom third. I don't believe that's the bottom third, but maybe the bottom quarter. But in this area here, yes, there would not be any trees in that location, with the exception of what they would have to replant.
Okay. So the Citizens Group last year hired Princeton Hydro, Keith Merle, and he walked the site, actually with me. And he said that based on the geology, because he is a geologist, that the soils are very loose, and that's what makes them such great aquifer recharge. He said that that even a 200-foot buffer, as protected under POD zoning, was inadequate because, in his opinion, that when you cut into those loose soils, they would collapse. in his opinion, and he also said that retaining walls would be very expensive to put on this property because, again, the types of soils you were trying to keep behind the walls, that you might be able to build those walls, but you were going to have to constantly be maintaining them because they were such loose soils, they were not meant for development. Are we going to hire a geologist to verify, because I can't see how a ridge of 380 feet can survive in a 93-foot undisturbed buffer. It doesn't make any sense that it won't collapse.
Well, I can tell you, let me say that it's an interesting point that you raise. If the settlement were to go forward, that's obviously an issue that the planning board would have to consider. I'm assuming that the developer has done enough due diligence to realize how they're going to deal with that issue. If they didn't, that's their risk. But that's an issue that the planning board would have to consider as part of a site plan application.
But what's the risk? Because once they've cleared it and they've cut into it, it's almost like you can't do anything at that point.
They can't cut into it until they would get planning board approval. And the issues that you're raising would be reviewed as part of an application before the planning board. They would not be able to, you know, to do any of the work out there on the site unless and until they first received their preliminary site plan approval from the board.
But as a planner, have we looked at any of this geology, and do we look at the 380-foot elevation, and is it feasible it can survive in a 93-foot undisturbed buffer?
I think what you're saying as far as a 380-foot elevation, there's not going to be a 380-foot degree of cut here. There is that existing contour of 380 feet above sea level. That might be slightly deceiving from what the actual plan is showing here. What the cut is approximately what I was just mentioning, maybe 8 to 12, maybe 15 feet along Intervale Road on this side. And in fact, what happens is that the grades rise back up to a sort of a high point at about 75 feet off of Intervale Road, and then drop back down on the backhand side. Everyone's familiar with the side slopes you see along Intervale, and those are going to be preserved. They're actually within your first 50 feet or so of the right-of-way area along Intervale. And so, in fact, what's going to happen with the proposed grades that are here, as well as the grades on the roadway, if you were to strike a section through here, you would actually see that the ridge line is higher than the actual building itself, the building being about 28 feet thereby.
But that's again says that the soils aren't so loose that they are not going to collapse, that they really can, you really can cut them and it'll stay, and that's not what the geologists believed.
Well, he's basing that on, and I was there for his testimony, and I believe he's basing that on soil maps without actually doing soil borings
right.
in the
and
area.
And
the soil borings
right.
are very important,
okay.
as what was mentioned, Mr. Inglesino, a moment ago, was that the soil borings are required at the planning board level. So we understand right. what the stability of those soils are and understand what the technique is.
Ma'am, your time's up. At this time, we're going to take one more person at this time, and we're going to schedule another meeting that people that have not been given the opportunity to speak yet or people that have not attended this meeting that would like to speak can come up and ask questions as well. Is there anyone else?
No, I'll take it.
Go ahead. Only because we still have our regular agenda meeting that we have to go.
I understand. I'll be very quick about it. I don't need the whole 3 minutes. I want to thank, first of all, the council members that voted against it last October. Thank you very much. I hope I can thank you again soon and the new council members. And that the new council members that I remember walking into this meeting were handing out their campaign promises, some of them saying they were against this. So I hope to thank you guys again. But quickly, I don't want to repeat everything that's negative about this.
Sir, could you just state your name and address?
Oh, I'm sorry. Frank Gingaro, 27 Homer Street, residence for 50 years. But I don't want to repeat all the negative stuff about this because there's a lot of it. But I don't know, maybe I missed it when the man was talking about this the presentation up here, but You're covering 17-something acres of land with now concrete. Where is all, we have a storm, 5-plus inches of rain. Where is all this water going? I live along Troy Brook, so do a lot of other people. Troy Brook goes through the Parsippany. I know it floods in a lot of different areas. I countless nights I lay awake when I know there's storms coming. We're having more frequent storms. And this is nothing. There's a lot of negative things about it. This is another big negative thing. Where is all this water going to when it falls, that all this land? I mean, I don't know if the presenter, I'm sorry, I might have missed it when you were talking. Is any of it going to reach this brook? I mean, I think Troy Brook is right behind this, if I'm not mistaken. Plus, it goes along into the Hills of Troy neighborhood, which I'll tell you, we got enough problems with everything around us. The post office, the Waterview Park and Ride, the recycling center. I mean, I have a couple inches of rainfall. My brook is halfway up my backyard. They're working on Route 80 right now. They're building another, the Porsche dealership, which has already been there, I understand, but they're ripping up trees. And where is all this water going to go? I mean, it's bad enough as it is. And I don't, you know, that's just another negative about this whole situation. Please, vote against it like you did last time. I've been here for 50 years. I don't want to leave, but just about the water, is this thing somehow heading towards Troy's Brook, if this is ever proposed?
What the developer has indicated on the plan is an actual area of stormwater infiltration basin at the lowest portion of the site. So they're looking to collect the water and recharge it into the ground in accordance with the stormwater regulations.
The stormwater regulations do not permit any increase in runoff. So you're going to have impervious surface, obviously, so let's say hypothetically there'll be a lot more water running off the site. The DEP regulations require that there be no net runoff, and Ed, maybe you can elaborate on that a little bit, because that's it's an important point. It's a legitimate concern, but it is one that the state regulations do address in a very specific and strong way.
Certainly. The state regulations actually required Parsippany, as well as all the communities throughout New Jersey, to adopt stormwater regulations that require the no net runoff from the site, and that what the development techniques that are usually implemented to deal with that situation are is a feature such as the infiltration basin, and or what you may not see in some developments is the subsurface infiltration that may occur in a parking lot. What has currently been indicated to us is that they were going to do it all by surface recharge, which is actually a preferred method of the stormwater infiltration model and the ordinances that they require us to take a look at.
I'm not sure if I understood all that, but
the development will not make any stormwater runoff or any flooding on adjacent properties any worse. It can't. There's requirements with regard to collection of water.
I'm hoping that's true.
That have to be met.
Which, if you lived along the brook, it's a little brook, but it floods. And I mean, my life is there.
This won't make that worse. I can't guarantee it would make it better, but it won't make it worse.
Well, then maybe the town can do something making it better along Troy Brook. And I think just one last point. The woman that made the point about the virus spreading, I think that's a big point there. I mean, this is a success. My neighborhood, right off of Cherry Hill Road, there's an empty office building there that's overgrown now. It looks like hell, but excuse my French. But what's going to stop them from saying, you know, let's try this, and we could put a little mall here. Maybe, I mean, this could be a virus. I mean, I just think everything about this is negative. But like I said, thank you for the members who voted it down, and I hope that you stick to your word next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, before we end the meeting, our next meeting will be Monday the 15th. It will be at the Hills here, Parsippany Hills High School, at 7 p.m.
Okay. Sir, could we just have one more minute? We wait to work through all the water view. I wanted to talk to you about something that was in the minutes about the Manor Lake.
That's a different. That can be brought up at our agenda meeting, which is following this meeting. In 5-10 minutes, we'll be having our agenda meeting. You can bring that up there. Yes, at the open. Yes, yes.
Okay.
At this time, I entertain a motion to close the public.
Make a motion.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Valori, seconded by Mr. Stanton. Roll call.
Mr. Peluso.
Yes.
Mr. Stanton.
Yep.
Mr. Valori.
Yes.
Mr. Carifi.
Yes.
Township of Parsippany Troy Hills Township Council Agenda Meeting, September 9th, 2014. Meeting called to order by myself at 10:13 p.m. Roll call.
Mr. Carrifi.
Here.
Mr. Peluso.
Present.
Mr. Stanton.
Here.
Mr. Valori.
Here.
Others present, Mayor James R. Barberio, Ellen M. Sandman, Business Administrator, Paula Cosarelli, Assistant Business Administrator, John Inglesino, Esquire, Township Attorney, Yancey Wazermas, Township Clerk, and Ann M.
Cucci,
CFO. The purpose of this meeting is to set the agenda for the regular Township Council meeting of September 23rd, 2014. Formal action may or may not be taken.
Statement of compliance. Adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in accordance with the requirements of the Open Public Meetings Law by filing the notice in the office of the Township Clerk and by posting the meeting notice on the bulletin board at the Municipal Building on December 18, 2013, where it has remained posted since that date. A legal notice appeared on both the Daily Record on December 20, 2013 and the Star Ledger on December 23, 2013 and was forwarded by fax to other local newspapers and radio stations on December 18, 2013. In addition, adequate notice of this location change of this meeting has been provided in accordance with the requirements of the Open Public Meetings Law by filing the notice in the office of the Township Clerk by posting the notice on the bulletin board at the Municipal Building on the September 2nd, 2014, where it has remained posted since that date. A legal notice appeared in the Daily Record on September 4, 2014 and was forwarded by fax to the Star Ledger, Parsippany Life, and local radio stations on the September 2nd, 2014. No council meetings are videotaped and aired on Cablevision Public Access Channel 21 at 11 a.m. on Sundays and are also available for viewing at www.parsippany.net.
Ordinances for second readings and public hearings. We all set on those?
Yes, they're all ready. Okay.
Okay, status of adopted ordinances. Ordinance 2014:20, that failed on August 19th, 2014. Ordinance 2014:21, adopted date August 19th, mayoral action August 21st, effective date September 10th. Ordinance 2014:22, adopted date August 19th, 2014, mayoral action August 21st, 2014, effective date September 10th, 2014. And ordinance 2014:23 failed on August 19th, 2014. Ordinances 2014:24, 25, 26, and 27. The adopted dates were all August 19th, 2014, mayoral action August 21st, 2014, effective date September 15th, 2014. Discussion, reminders, scheduled meetings, actually we have a special meeting, which will be on the 15th of September, here at Parsippany Hills High School at 7 p.m. We have our regular meeting scheduled for September 23rd, 2014 at 7:30 p.m. and on October 7th, 2014 at 7:30 p.m. an agenda meeting. Minutes for approval, none. Administration? Anything?
Nothing. I think they're pretty clear as to what was rejected and what was approved.
Bids taken?
Yes.
Okay. Quotations, proposals, qualifications. Received on August 6, 2014 at 11 a.m. sealed qualification statements for health insurance broker of record services. Requested none. Ordinances, none. Discussion, food trucks. Resolutions, we're all set for those. Yancey?
Yes, I just have one more. I received about an hour before the meeting, so I didn't have time to update the agenda. It's from the planning board. They're requesting a soil moving permit for Forge Pond Developers. If it's okay, I'd like to have that on the consent agenda for the 23rd.
Yes.
Thank you.
We have to do the table.
Okay. Okay, tabled from previous meeting. R-2014-132, resolution of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills waiving auction permit fees, the PAL. And R-2014-135.
Council President, before you go on, I think Yancey just wants to address some additional information with regard to that one, and I would like to add some additional information to 135. Yancey?
For 132, the question came up at the last meeting for the event that was going to be benefiting from the auction fees, which is what you're going to be, which is what the request is to waive. Mr. Tony Ben, I'm sorry, I can't pronounce his last name.
Bonavitacola?
Yes, thank you. He's written another letter, and he's made it very clear that he will not be using now those funds for that boxing event, but they will be placed in the Parsippany PAL general account for other events. So if the council's okay, I'll just place the resolution back on, possibly with a new number, because 132 is the old number, which was now used for the Rockaway watershed.
All right, don't we have to vote on this tonight? Because there's an.
He said he can wait. He's going to postpone the auction.
Oh, okay.
So that way it could be placed on the 23rd.
Anyone opposed to that?
Nope.
No. Okay, good. You can place that on.
All right, thank you.
And Council President, with regard to 135, a councilman had asked what the funding was, you know, how things were going to be paid, and we researched it quite thoroughly. The TWTC agreement, there were questions as to the $1,000 that I did find within the document. This $1,000 is for, includes all legal fee reviews. Administration will produce an invoice inclusive of all legal fees in connection with legal fees review and agreement, and that's what the money is for. That $1,000 that is pledged through there, it cannot exceed $1,000, but that will be paid to us. But as far as other factors, the right-of-way agreement allows access to township-wide. Permits are not necessary for work that are done on poles, aerial work, and permits are required through engineering only if there's excavation, and that's a $30 right-of-way permit. And we clarified all this. So this document is, you know, all the tenets of the document are proper. And as far as compensation, it's only the allotment of $1,000 for the preparation of this. And this probably comes down from the FCC, you know, for the for communication purposes. Does that answer,
your
question? Okay. And Council President, if we could put this back on then?
Yes.
There was no time element involved.
Yes.
And I will get this document to you.
You can place
that
on
there. Write up on it, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Township Office Reports, Engineering Report, Mr. Stanton.
Okay, status of road resurfacing, put in stone area. Developer installed the water main sanitary sewer line, portion put in stone road. Township accepted ownership of sanitary main at November 12, 2013 council meeting. Installation of sanitary laterals has been completed. Paving of the road will take place this month. No action required. Manor Lake Dam. Manor Lake's the only township owned lake. The dam's in need of replacement. Consultant has been working with DEP, obtained permits for a replacement, dredging a sediment from the lake. Revised hydraulic, H&H study was sent to DEP last week in response to DEP's latest comments. H&H study has been approved. Consultant's working on plans, permit documents. No change, no council action required. FEMA hazard mitigation grant program, no council action required.
Council President, I just would like to report for the record, because this is a significant thing that we're monitoring and watching very closely. I've been working closely with our new finance director and also with engineering. As you may or may not even recall, but it's to the extent of $4.2 million that has, as you can see, 90% completion. So we are diligently pursuing. We received all the documentation back. It looks to be in fine fashion. And at yesterday's work agenda with the various department heads, it was reported that we have been in contact with our FEMA representative, and we're going to start processing these documents because we want to make sure we receive all our $4 million back sooner than later. So we're really monitoring it very closely. And I just wanted to, you know, in addition to that, we're on top of that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Chief Financial Officer, anything? No? Okay. Township Attorney?
No report. We're open anyway.
Township offices, committees? Communications, correspondence, none. Applications, none. Before we go to the public hearing, I just have one question of the administration. I was contacted. Mr. Dolsky is a big proponent for two items going with the town, the JCP&L
yes.
project, and also that Pilgrim pipeline. And he had asked if the town, if we could host a meeting on, I believe it's December 10th.
Well, we're going to contact the...
In reference to the Pilgrim pipeline?
The pipeline one. We're going to... why doesn't it work?
Yeah, it doesn't seem to.
The pipeline one, we're going to contact that to get that day. It might not be the 10th, though.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, just so that we could have... I mean, we were
host it in town.
We were the first council in the state to...
Correct.
...take action.
Yes.
All right.
...posing that, and I think it would be... Nice for us to host that.
Mr. Council President, can I add, we also received a phone call from a councilwoman in upstate New York also asking for a copy of the resolution.
Nice.
So you're the first council in both states.
Great.
Very good.
Okay, thank you.
We'll get back to you very
soon. Great, thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you.
Okay, at this time, entertain a motion to open up the public hearing.
Motion.
Motion made by Mr. Peluso.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Stanton. Roll call.
Mr. Peluso?
Yes.
Mr. Stanton?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Mr. Karifi?
Yes. Okay, at this time you'll be given 5 minutes. Please come up, sign in, state your name and address.
Hi, good evening. Thank you for your patience. It's a little bit past my bedtime, but I'm here on behalf of Manor Lake. And I know it's been an old issue for many years.
Could you just state your name and address, please?
Oh, Beverly Seabrook, 5 Maple Way, right down the street from Manor Lake. I've lived here for 45 years, and we've had seen this lake come and go. And right now, it's on its way out. And
as a man said, a picture is worth 1,000 words. I don't know how many of you have ever been to Manor Lake. Was also given to you or taken years ago when they first started this 2 or 3 years ago. But it's worse than ever. All the wildlife is gone. The birds are no longer there.
We were bothered by the Canadian geese at one time, but even they cannot even stand it. It's filled with algae, and you know, at this time we don't know if it's bad algae or if it's just a non-toxic algae. But it's really a mess, and all the fish are gone. The kids used to fish in the pool and go ice skating in the winter, and there were even small crafts like little canoes and things that it was a part of our way of life and our way of living, and to me that is a very valuable part. And we don't have to buy anything. We don't have to use open spaces money for it. It's right there. It just needs to be cleaned up. Now, and another factor is from a medical standpoint, it's a mosquito-infested area also. And as you might know or might not know, the West Nile virus is a very potent neurovirus, and the CDC recommends emptying all standing water. Well, this is standing water that's always there. And there are 11 counties were tested in New Jersey. Morris was one of them that had positive for the West Nile. Last year, 2 people died and 10 got very, very sick from it. The peak season is Friday through October for the mosquito infestation. Now, there's another mosquito, which I can't even pronounce the name of, but it's it comes out in the daytime and it causes a lot of joint pain that lasts for months and months. And you also have, and that was also 497 cases, 25 in New Jersey. We also have the dengue fever, 13 in New Jersey, caused by mosquitoes. It was said by the CDC, if you have a swimming pool that's unintended and left without any filtration or any chlorination, you would have, that would be enough mosquitoes to infect the entire neighborhood. Well, we have a swamp in our backyard. I don't live on the lake, but the other people do. And one lady has not been able to sell her house because of the, you wouldn't buy a house in a cesspool like that. So we're just asking you to please inform us. I know the manor is on here and the dam was broken, but if we could be somehow informed as to the progress and what's going on and the new engineer and a new consultant and all the steps that are taken and that you're working towards some end, we would appreciate that. Okay?
Thank you.
I mean, that's why it's on there. That's how it got on there. You did a good job. Good job.
Good job.
She did a good job. Excellent. She did. Very well. Yeah, very respectful.
I have a...
Don't tell me. Hello. I'm Janet Chambers, and I'm at 19 Lakeside Drive, and my house does back up to the lake. The lake needs dredged now. It absolutely cannot wait. We need it done this season. That is only a simple permit from the DEP. I didn't know that until 2 years ago. That has nothing to do with the permit that is needed for fixing the dam or doing the silt basin addition. If in fact you haven't seen the lake for a long time, there is no public access. I mean, the town could certainly do that, but I welcome anybody that wants to come to my home, 19 Lakeside Drive, yellow house, American flag. You don't even have to knock on the door, walk down my driveway, you can look at the lake up close. You all did not start this horror story. It was started a long time ago by other administrations, but it's been a 25-year history. It's been perpetuated and also further damaged to the lake because you dredged at Manor Park. Walk to the park, too, while you're there and see that that project, done without any notice to any of us or discussion, and finished in 2012, is also an overgrown horror story. You can't even see the work that was done, and no one takes care of that either. I've only lived here 6 years. I've done everything right by redoing an 80-year-old home and adding value to my neighborhood. But this town has not fulfilled its responsibility to me and my neighborhood by maintaining the lake. In fact, you have devalued everything I've done. I can now sit on my $18,000, 775 square foot Trex deck and my balcony that I built off my master, and I have a view of a disgusting mess. I have written countless letters and emails to you, you all, the councilmen, town officials, everybody in 6 years, not only on my behalf, but others. I have never, ever had one response. Yet the website says, we'll get back to you shortly, but I've never heard from anyone. The issue of Manor Lake, I believe, must be made public and on the agenda for discussion at length. There are multiple issues attached to the lake problem. Number one, the problem is, who's in charge? Because nobody's been in charge the 6 years I've lived here. Anyway, I'm disgusted at the never-ending work, and I feel like I've had a part-time job with no pay trying to get this town to do what you willingly say is your duty and that you have the money. I moved here at age 61 for a peaceful life on a little lake, and frankly, I felt like my life has been destroyed and my dream destroyed living here. Maybe you could go for another award from the DEP instead of the one for the water treatment plant by being our heroes and remediating the lake. Immediately, the dredging would be great. I actually tried to sell my house the last two springs, and it is impossible to sell a house. And especially now, there is not one person actually on the lake that could sell their house. It is totally disgusting. So we're truly begging for your help.
I'm sorry, what is your first name, please?
Janet.
Janet, I just wanted to let you know, I'm here only two and a half months, and one of the first things I did get involved with was Manor Lake. One of the reasons why it is on the agenda and part of an update from the engineering office is because I asked them to put it on there.
Right.
I also know that you also realize DEP doesn't do any quick turnaround, but I can assure you, because I said to Justin, who was our engineer, I said, please, please, please keep contacting them. Don't wait for DEP to call you, because they'll never call you back. And we did get a six-week turnaround instead of a six-month turnaround that we can go forward. However, you are informing me about much more than just the dam. And I know Pat has told me about the dredging, and we have looked into it. And I've asked the question about the dredging. There is a concern about starting some part of the dredging until we get some additional information back from the engineer, who we are pushing every day, because we're concerned with certain dredging that it might do some damage to the dam. However, if you would, because of you and the others, I see that there is a group here. I will be making it even more my personal communication to all of you, and get more documentation on the meeting, and not just documentation just in words, but in action. So I make that commitment to you tonight.
Okay, appreciate that. Yeah, I wonder if you've been in contact with Sarah Hatala at the DEP, because I've been regularly in contact with her, and she's told me more than once that, you know, it's a simple permit for the dredging part. I mean,
yes,
I know the other stuff is complicated.
I was told that also, but then we got a counter counter to that was the contractor saying that there was some concern about, yes, you can get the permit, but exactly where they want to start to dredge might do some damage to the dam. So let me try to coordinate a little bit better. I am a pretty good communicator, because this is how I communicate, right into your face. So they kind of know that I'm concerned about it. So the mayor knows that. But I mean, I get some action. So that's why he moves away, I guess. I don't. But anyway, I'm sincere
about
this.
We appreciate your help. I mean, you
yes.
know, I've talked to.
I can't imagine doing all that improvement and then sitting outside, and then I've also just talked to two gentlemen here. One about the
I mean,
odor.
I've only been here 6 years, so I've seen it go downhill at the worst. You know.
No, and the other concern is the mosquitoes. You know, we'll try to
but,
do some immediate work.
The property values for myself and everyone directly around the lake, and to a lesser extent, the other people in the neighborhood, it's, I mean, my property value, I would say none of us that are on the lake could ever sell their house right now.
Right.
I mean, it's just, it's a horror. So
I will do my very best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
Thank you.
Mrs. Sandman, thank you for staying on top of that. I appreciate it. But can we also look into the park situation?
I realize
the park is overgrown as well.
Yeah, the whole thing. Yep.
Please,
absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
I'm Gene Schramm. I live across the street from Manor Lake. I look out my front windows.
What's your address, sir?
16 Lakeside Road, Lakeside Drive, whichever map you look at. I look out my front windows, and what I used to see when I moved in 30 years ago is, in the wintertime, people ice skating on that lake. I've seen people even swimming in the lake. Canoeing and whatnot. It was a nice little place. It's not big, but it has been very nice. Now it's a mud puddle. It really is. And you can pretty much walk across it. Now, there are two people who were unable to come tonight, and they asked me to read a letter that they would like to have you receive. I'm going to truncate it just a little bit to keep it short. This one is from Richard and Nancy Stone, 9 Orchard Way. They, in September of 1994, my husband and I moved to Parsippany. We were and are so impressed by the excellent service Parsippany gives to its residents. The garbage collection is outstanding. Forestry department seems to be on top of things, so too many trees are not removed from yards. Orchard Way was paved after I told because of large puddles in the street. And for several evenings, a policeman was parked out in front to see whether a street light that I requested could be put in by Jersey Central Power and Light. That request was granted because Orchard Way was too dark at night. Pride in Parsippany is your motto, and that is so true, as all your services have been excellent. However, the Pride in Parsippany motto cannot be used in regard to the small lake at the end of Orchard Way and along Lakeside, Manor Lake. Swans and ducks used to swim in that lake. We even worried turtles were killing the newborn swans. So the lake was quite nice and lovely to look at. Today it is a swamp. May even be an environmental hazard because it's so disgusting. No ducks or swans are swimming in the lake. I think one could even wade across the lake, which used to be at least 4 feet deep. Years ago, we did go to a meeting of the council and concerned residents and learned there was money in the budget to clean up Manor Lake. Why has it not been done? I do hope the lake will be fixed up soon. My husband and I are requesting those in charge to take care of this problem as soon as possible. No one can take pride in Parsippany if they see this lake. The other one is considerably shorter. It's from Jackie Hackett, 21 Lakeside Drive. Dear Mayor Barberio, I agree that Manor Lake has to be dredged immediately. The value of my home is in jeopardy, and I'm 84 years old. We have been waiting since 1999 to have the lake dredged. Some people have been waiting since 1989. I've been waiting since 1984. Basically, it's a bad situation. And I keep hearing we're working on the dam. Now, the dam is one problem, but the dredging is primarily upstream away from the dam. It's not right at the dam. I mean, there may be some that's needed down there, too, but the bulk of it is upstream. And there's really no reason why that couldn't be done right now. And this is an ideal time of year to do it. Why not do it? Okay.
Again, I assure you that I did ask that question, but now I will go back with more fervor and ask it again and then say I don't understand because of the distance. Mm-hmm. So I make that commitment to you. And I know the next meeting is the 15th, but the regular next meeting would be the 23rd, and I hope to have much more information for you by then, of action, not just words.
I would greatly appreciate that. I have to say, though, that I have heard words for a long time.
Right, that's why I said the word action.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. My name is Ken Kaplan. I live at 1480 Route 46, so I'm not in this immediate neighborhood. But I am good friends with Ms. Chambers, who spoke earlier, and I've personally seen the pain that she's gone through. And, you know, I've been on her deck, and I've seen this lake, and I've seen it get worse. When she first called it to my attention, I said, oh, it's not so bad. But it's gotten a lot worse, and it's really disgusting now. I mean, areas of mud that really are above the water line, and it's just a mess. It really needs to be remedied as soon as possible. And the concern that I have, and that some of these other people here have, is that in the past, they have been yes to death. I personally attended one meeting in Mr. Liz's office where he did assure us that progress was being made, and he said he would keep us advised of the progress, and then there was no communication thereafter. So this is the kind of thing we're concerned. We want to make sure, and from what I've heard tonight, it sounds like you are on it, but I want to make sure you follow through this time and give this a priority.
Okay.
Now also, once the dam is repaired and the dredging is done in the silt basin, once this is all taken care of, there has to be an ongoing plan to maintain this and to keep it the way it should be. So someone from the town has to be appointed, you know, conservator of the lake or something like that. They need to have the proper courses and lake management so that going forward, they can do what needs to be done. That might involve some aeration. It might involve, you know, controlling the flow in and out so you don't have standing water. But somebody needs to learn the proper methodology and to take care of it going forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Pat Patacha, 182 Hawkins Avenue. A couple of questions. The meeting, I think it was two meetings prior to this, I asked the council and Ellen to verify whether or not this was on our website, on any website or any computer, the GOVTV, the GOTV vote the Alpha Dog has on their thing. I wanted to make sure it was not part of the township website. I asked that a couple of weeks ago. Did anybody remember I gave you the copy to make sure that this was not out there?
Do you want to wait till the end? Do you have other questions?
Yeah, I have other questions. Okay. Yeah.
We'll just wait till the end and we'll answer.
Okay. The next one is, Ellen, I also asked at that time if it was possible to get a list of the policemen that were retiring or possibly retiring and the payouts that would go with that. And not for nothing, but I didn't see it tonight. I didn't know enough to look, but as of last week, that IMS sign was still up saying it IMS Road. So maybe you should check into that. Mayor Barbario left. Ellen, do you have any idea of how much money we brought in on the mayor's golf camp? How much money came in on that? How much did we make?
On the which?
The mayor's golf camp. He had a golf camp.
I'll go back to the one question I wanted to answer. On that,
wait,
I have
wait,
to...
Wait,
oh, is she finished
her,
with... Oh,
no,
I know. I thought, I
is
know
that
if
it
you're
for
not
your
done.
Questions?
Yeah,
I got one more.
Okay, one
you got,
more.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay. The next one isn't really a question. It's been on the agenda for a while. I mentioned it a while ago. And that's the one, the revision to the escrow requirements. Ellen, this has been on our agenda sheet for at least 5 years. I mean, the people are all taken care of. The only outstanding thing is whether or not to reduce the amount of the escrow required for certain work. I mean, I think we should be able to do that, you know, after 5 years. I would like to have Ellen's answers now and stop my clock at the moment, please.
I'll do the last one first. When we were reviewing the council agenda tonight, I also read through Justin's report, more so for the manner, but also I did pick up on that. Yeah, I think you're right. I think we can get some new information on some other topic that might be more current and more, yeah. So that will change. What was the one? We're aware of the sign. We just talked to that today. We are looking into that. In fact, Council Rob had asked that question.
This one, you don't.
That one. You know that one. I can't. I apologize. Did you hand it to me in the hallway?
No. Yeah.
I gave everybody a copy.
Okay, I get that. But no, you asked me something else, and I had an answer. I had the answer on that one. Ann, who's just picking up, I've talked to Ann, we're working on those numbers. We've really had, with regard to the changes in finance, and we're right now working on on Tuesday the 16th, we're taking in notes for $36 million, selling notes. And the documentation, because of, you know, I'm there 15 minutes, Anne's there 2 minutes, and we lost Katie also. So it's been a, you know, we've really been very, very busy making sure that all that documentation is together, and it did take quite some time. So that those numbers, we can pull those together now.
Okay.
Yeah. Actually has them. We just didn't get them. Yeah.
Okay.
She did start that, but again, I'm being very, you know, she's only been there 5 days, 6 days, and already doing a pretty good job. But all things.
Hey, Anne.
No, she really has. I mean, you know, you go in and you say, she came back the next day. Anyway. That we will have that, and again, I apologize on this one.
Okay.
With all the stuff, you know.
Okay.
But I'm very. I didn't get. You know. I know the council president says there is an administrative part, but I'm very, very hopeful that we get very good rates on our sale. We've worked really hard on the OS official statement, and I'm very pleased the way it turned out and working together. And in addition to that, one of the other elements that just add more and more things that we're working on is a thing called Emma, and it's this electronic. We have to talk about all our debt service that's out there and all the details. But because the council moved quickly on the Phoenix Advisors, we were the first kids on the block to get it done, and that will be very helpful in our sale of our notes. So I'm looking for to report at the meeting on the 23rd how successful we were on that. So
okay.
Bear with me on some of the things I couldn't get to do.
Okay.
But we're working on the numbers. And again, this one, just I'll be honest with you.
Just sweet.
I'm pretty good, but some days.
Okay.
You know,
not a problem.
Okay? No.
I'll give you credit.
Thank you.
May
and then, you know, I have that new baby.
Yeah.
My granddaughter. Thank you.
Mayor Barbaro, you're back now. Could you tell me how much the town took in for the golf camp that was run?
I can't hear you.
The golf camp that was run, how much did the town take in on that?
How much was made at the golf camp?
We'll have to get a figure. I don't have those figures on me right now, Pat. I'll have Paula get it to you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, because I don't have my
notes.
Okay. What do I have left in time?
About a minute.
Okay. In case I don't finish in a minute, I will ask that you bear with me for 1 minute longer. I just want to address something that happened last week at the last meeting. At the last meeting, just prior to the adjournment of the meeting, our attorney, Mr. Inglesino, wanted to speak. He asked for permission, and you gave him permission to speak. And at that time, what he told you was that he asked you whether or not any of you were aware that my ethics complaint was denied. Now, I'd like to answer that. First of all, I love the fact that he waited until just before adjournment. There is a spot for the attorney to speak at, and that's the spot he should have spoke at. That's number one. Now, I'll explain. This is going so far back. We all know that at a meeting last year, Mr. Inglesino refused to let me speak and kept speaking over me. And I kept saying he was denying me my freedom of speech. I warned you all that he was denying me my freedom of speech. It happened, it kept happening, it went on. I contacted the ACLU. They found Mr. Inglesino had violated my constitutional rights. Okay, I have that letter, I have proof. They told him he violated my constitutional rights. Okay. Then what happened was, all of a sudden, I send this into the ethics committee. Mind you, I'll tell you, it's not dead in the water. I'm not done yet. I sent it to the ethics committee. And lo and behold, the ethics committee does not think that a lawyer taking away your freedom of speech is unethical. Okay? So, going with that, you know, they said that and the other thing, I'm sitting here going, huh. Nobody seems to know what the word, what the definition of ethics is, okay? And then I found out that there was a whistleblower in the State Ethics Commission. And now they're all being investigated and stuff going on. All because there's talk of it being a Christie thing. Now, since I heard that it was a Christie thing, of course, then I started thinking. So I went to other places to find out my options, and I do have other options, okay? So it's not as though I didn't tell anybody. Every council member up there, except maybe Mr. Stanton, I'm not sure, that I spoke to privately and told them that I got that response from the Ethics Committee. I'm very honest when it comes to things like that. I told them after I received it. You told them last week. That letter you received in April. Why did you hold on so long? Okay, I don't want a response from you, Mr. Inglesino, tonight. All as I want from you is to let you know that I am an honest person. I tell it like it is. I don't deny if I make a mistake. I admit it. But I am not done yet. So when I'm done, then you'll get my answers. But please, don't sit here and throw out something on a resident.
Thank you. Oh, no. Sir, you already spoke.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah. No, once you leave the, our policies, once you leave the microphone, it's...
I just want to ask you a very quick question, not about the LA, just generally, about the communication system of the online, you know, the town website, because I did write to you, gentlemen, prior to this and did not get any response. I was just wondering if you got the communication or if there's something wrong with the website that needs to be addressed. That's all.
Okay.
Yes.
Keith Hawkins, 81 Wingate Road.
Can you speak up?
I'm sorry. Keith Hawkins, 81 Wingate Road.
Yeah.
Lou, you know where I live. You used to live down the street. I just want to ask where the Boy Scouts stands on the resolution to allow us to use free use of the park facilities.
It's on the agenda.
It's on the agenda.
It wasn't mentioned when we were going over the agenda notes.
No one has a problem with it, I think. Yeah. That's why it wasn't mentioned.
It's on there.
So, okay.
Keith, if I say it's on there, it's on there.
I know. I'm just trying
just
to make sure for the people that are asking me, are we all done and is this over? And I know I'm going to get a letter from the Recreation Department saying, when are you going to pay your $50 fee?
No,
I want to make sure I don't get that.
I will assure you, you will never get that letter.
I certainly
hope so. Because I have spoken to that gentleman.
That's because it's up to 75 now.
I would like to thank the council and the administration for helping the scouts in this matter. Thank you.
Thank you for waiting.
You will. Thank you.
Okay. Poor Keith, you waited all night here.
Okay, see no one else come forward. Entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Make a motion.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Valori, seconded by Mr. Stanton. Roll call.
Mr. Peluso.
Yes.
Sorry, I didn't hear you.
Yes.
Mr. Stanton.
Yes.
Mr. Valori. Mr. Valori.
Yes.
Mr. Carrifi.
Yes. Closed session resolution, whereas the Open Publics Meeting Act, PL 1975, Chapter 231, permits the exclusion of the public from a meeting in certain circumstances, and whereas the Township Council is of the opinion that such circumstances presently exist, and whereas the Township Council wishes to discuss attorney-client privilege, contract negotiations, and Putting Stone Developers versus Persephone, and whereas minutes will be kept once the matter involving the confidentiality of the above no longer requires confidentiality, the minutes can be made public. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Township Council of the Township of Persephone Troy Hills that the public be excluded from this meeting.
Second.
Motion to adjourn by myself, seconded by Mr. Stanton. Roll call.
Mr. Peluso.
Yes.
Mr. Stanton.
Yes.
Mr. Valori.
Yes.
Mr. Carrifi.
Yes.
Do you want to go?
Make a motion to reconvene.
Open session.
Motion. Motion made by Mr. Stanton, seconded by Mr. Paluso. Roll call.
Mr. Paluso.
Yes.
Mr. Stanton.
Yes.
Mr. Valori's not here. Mr. Karifi.
Yes.